It is my pleasure to introduce to you our next speaker, Mr. Arturo Condo. He is a young global leader from the World Economic Forum. Arturo was also the rector who preceded Mr. Bolaños. Arturo received the Distinguished Scholar Award from INCAE, who's only been granted to 7 people in INCAE's history. He then obtained his doctorate degree from HBS with a dissertation that was supervised by Michael Porter. Arturo has worked as a strategic consultant for public and private companies, competitive strategy, strategic decision making, expansion, and international strategy. He's also worked with the IDB and World Bank and is a member of the Advisory Oath Project Council that was created by the World Economic Forum. Please welcome Mr. Arturo Condo.
Good morning. It's a pleasure to be here. Thanks very, very much, Alexandra, Olivia, the whole MBA Oath Club for the invitation. Thanks everyone for being here. Thanks everyone who's connecting from other places to be virtually here. It is a very special moment for me because this is an event that has been maybe four and some years in the making, in the sense that when the Business MBA Oath Club was started almost 5 years ago here at INCAE, one of the key goals that we defined for the club, and by we I mean the founders of the club, MBA students, but also some of us who were very, very involved in the beginning, was that to make this not only an INCAE thing, but eventually to really spread the word and really reach out. It took maybe longer than we thought. Actually, it's a pleasure to have Professor Gentile here because this was planned to occur a year ago. And luckily and generously, she agreed to come, postponed. She took the rain check of the invitation, and she's here now a year later. So very, very special, because I think what the MBA Oath Club at INCAE has created and built over the past few years is really solid, I think, and I think it's really needed. So the club leaders asked me to sort of push forward on the theme and the argument made already by our president, Enrique Bolaños, on why this could be important. But I also wanted to share with you my personal connection with this, because I'm a strategy professor. I'm not an ethics professor. But in December 2004, here in Costa Rica, a couple of media companies, a newspaper and a TV network, exposed complicated connections of corruption. And involved those news involved 3 different presidents. 2 of them were indicted. Presidents of the country, 2 were indicted. They even went to jail. So we had worked to get very close to 2 of those 3 presidents as far as the think tank work that INCAE has done in the region. And I was personally particularly affected, in the sense that when you were with people who are trying to do the right thing, who are trying to build a new society for their people, for their compatriots, really you think the best of everyone, at least at the beginning. And so that was a big hit for me, and not that I wasn't aware of ethical problems or ethical challenges, but that made a big difference. With one colleague of mine here at INCAE, we wrote a case on that. It's a case that we've been using for the past decade. That was in 2005. And that brought me to this world of ethics. And it was interesting because I haven't found a single person who openly says, we have to be crooks, or we have to cheat, or we have to take advantage of other people, or whatever. I haven't. And I'm sure I've met corrupt people that I don't know, but I'm sure in secret they are planning to do stuff, perhaps. But not openly, at least not to me. And so the awareness of what we say and what we do and the difference between those 2 things began to be very, very strong with me. The other big thing, personally, was the 2008-2009 crisis. I was the president of INCAE at the time. As Olivia mentioned, I was part of the Young Global Leaders community within the World Economic Forum. And so, obviously, the crisis was very significant in that many, many decisions were made that actually provoked and created the crisis. Many decisions, by the way, not just a few bankers. Really, it was a network of decisions. And I was interviewed, as president of INCAE at that time, I was interviewed by a North American media and a newspaper, and it was I was asked, business schools have a responsibility because it was MBAs who created this mess. And I was like, wait, let's go slowly. And not everyone involved was an MBA, number one. And I sort of joked with a journalist that if there was one thing that everyone involved had in common more than having an MBA degree was that they all spoke English. And of course I was sort of joking, but I could bet that was a more, you know, pervasive feature of everyone involved because it was international finance, etc. So everyone was speaking English, I'm sure. Not everyone had an MBA, I'm sure about that as well. So I was half joking in the sense that no, it's not the MBA per se, right? And I also made the point that there are millions of MBAs out there in the world actually doing great things, building companies, creating jobs in a very ethical and the best way they can. But that said, of course, we business schools have a responsibility. Of course, we need to be more explicit about what we think the right role of business is in society. And so at the same time, in Davos 2009, we invited the now Dean of Harvard Business School, Nitin Noria, and Rakesh Khurana, who is also YGL, a young global leader, who had just written this article on the need of an oath. An oath that actually outlines what are the responsibilities of a business leader. Once you take other people's resources and society's resources, you're responsible beyond just the narrow tenet of your job. So responsibility is not only to increase sales, your responsibility is not only to, you know, reduce costs, your responsibility is not only to, you know, sell the brand or increase the brand value. You have a bigger responsibility because as a manager, as a professional manager, you are entrusted with other people's resources, their time. Every employee is given their time, they're committing for a time frame to the reputation of the company, of course, the value that the company creates. They will rise with the company, they can also sink with the company. Societies, you know, putting in your hands a number of resources, environmental resources, many times, you know, not really internalized in costs. Many externalities are managed by managers. And so the responsibility had to be open. And so the oath itself, I think, was the first step in making explicit what is expected of us. Now, we need to do more than that. When one of the founders of the MBA Oath Club, Arin Kaye, came to me, I don't remember the year now, but 5 years ago, he said, you know what, I respect what you're doing, the YGL Oath, all that, very nice, but those are only words, he said. And he was obviously right, and I was like, I know. But, you know, you have to begin with something, and he said, well, we need to do more. And that's how the Kaye MBA Oath Club was born. I know all the ideas and all the things that we're, you know, going to listen and talk to and what you've talked about are key components, a problem even more is needed to do the things that we're saying need to be done. And in Latin America, I believe that's particularly important because here we're really, really good at saying great things. So we're masters of literature, but we're not masters of action. And we have Nobel Prizes of Literature and they are fantastic. So we're fantastic at talking the right things and singing the right songs and writing the right books. What we're not that fantastic at is at doing the right things that we say need to be done. And so I think that's the challenge. I think that's why the MBA Oath Club was born, to make that happen. And I celebrate that we have Professor Mergentil here because one of her big, unique approaches to ethical issues is not so much talking about what's ethical and what isn't, but actually about how do you do the things you think are ethical. And you know, only supervillains in Disney movies are really plotting behind a curtain since they are small to be, you know, really evil. And one enjoys these movies, and of course when the good guy wins, it's fine. But in real life, actually, we were all raised to do the right thing. Our moms, church, anyone with influence usually tells us when we were little, you need to do the right thing. And there are many books written on this and how even people who have been involved in super complicated cases of wrongdoing didn't start to do it that way. So it is about how to do that. And that's why the club is crucial. And that's why it's fantastic to have Emery here. And as President Bolaños already said, this is core to our mission, core to the essence of our mission at Arin Kaye, and I would bet at any business school, you know, trying to educate leaders. But it's also a practical thing. We don't want to be the business school of the next, you know, where all our graduates are involved in the next huge corruption case in Latin America. And whenever, when things come to the media, it's not a good thing either. So even on self-interest alone, I think it's crucial. But of course, in our essence and the mission that President Bolaños already outlined is more critical than ever. So I celebrate that we're here. I'm really happy to spend this morning and some discussing and talking and starting to think more practically about these things. Thank you very much for the invitation.
Thank you, Dr. Kondo, for setting the tone perfectly for our introduction, our brief introduction for the MBA Oath Club. We are a student-run club that is made up of one club. We are present in both of the INCAE campuses, one in Costa Rica and one in Nicaragua. Today, we are present the INCAE leaders. We have Alexandra Rogosinski, who is our president, Fernando Jimenez, he is our secretary. We also have Diego, he's our communications officer, and Juan Pablo Lopez, he is our treasurer. We also have a team in Nicaragua, and we work closely together. We also have our big group of student members. Most of you are present today, and we are proudly wearing our shirts.